This is Food Safety First with your host, Ryan Ramdass.
Welcome to the Food Safety First podcast, the podcast where we discuss food safety topics related to the food manufacturing industry. I'm your host, Ryan Ramdass. In today's episode, we will discuss inspection systems, x-rays, and metal detectors. My guest today is Steve Gidman, the president of Fortress Technology. Steve is a leading industry expert with decades of experience in detection. He was our first guest on episode one, and I'm pleased to welcome him back on this episode two of Food Safety First. Welcome, Steve.
Thank you. Great to be here.
You know what? Before we dive in, I just want to quickly thank all our viewers, our listeners, I want to thank all our listeners for their support and their feedback after episode one. I think when we started off this podcast, we said we were going to let it grow organically, see where it takes us, and the feedback that we received was great, and that's why we're here today. So listeners, thank you so much. We actually have an email address, foodsafetyfirst@fortresstechnology.com. If you have any feedback, questions, comments, email us, foodsafetyfirst@fortresstechnology.com. Okay, Steve, so let's start. Let's start with inspection systems. We're talking about x-rays and metal detectors. A lot of the feedback that we received was with the Food Safety Modernization Act, buyers, owners, customers, they're all game. They're all on board of this prevention, but there's a lot of noise out there. They don't know what to pick. So I started doing my research, started looking in, and I'm gonna wear my purchasing hat. I'm gonna come to you as a purchaser and ask you for help, because doing the search, looking online, I'm seeing metal detectors versus x-ray, upgrade to metal detector, upgrade to x-ray. So just really wanna, I think, start from there, which system to choose, which one is better. Maybe we just compare and contrast the two systems. How's that sound?
Yeah, that's great.
Okay, so let's just take a step back. Can you tell us how a metal detector works?
Yeah, a metal detector is a radio frequency, basically transmit-receive system. And as such, it really can detect metals only, anything that's conductive or magnetic. Either one of those two characteristics will affect the field of a metal detector, and if they're large enough, they'll create a detectable signal. So anything that is metal has one of those characteristics or both of those characteristics. So stainless steel, copper, aluminum, brass, bronze, ferrous metals, but all metals. Not much else, unless it's conductive or it is magnetic.
And how about an x-ray? How does an x-ray?
X-ray is actually an older technology, and it's basically a density discriminator. So it's basically a light frequency at high energy that is passed through the product to be inspected, received on the other side of that product. And anything that's very dense will tend to block the light waves, the x-ray waves. And anything that's low density, it will pass through. So it's a density discriminator.
Okay, so, I mean, x-rays are what's everywhere. It's in the airports, it's around. I guess to me, it's more expensive, it's better. It's what's readily there. Isn't an x-ray a better machine because it could see everything?
Yeah, a bit of a misconception. It is a density detection system. So the simple answer is, what can an x-ray machine detect in a food product? And the simple way is, get a glass of water, put any contaminant that you think you might want to detect into that glass of water. If it sinks like a stone, as the saying goes, that's probably going to be detectable contaminant. If it takes its time or it floats, it's not going to be detectable with any x-ray machine. So you get the wood, feathers, bugs, so forth. None of that is detectable with x-ray. And some metals are virtually impossible to see with x-ray as well. So when you look at very thin aluminum, pop can style of aluminum, so you take a pop can, cut it in three or four large pieces, probably none of those pieces are going to be detectable with an x-ray machine inside or on top of a food product. So it's actually an easier technology to understand, because you can visualize, everybody can visualize a light path and a beam passing through a food product. And also the X-ray machine gives you a nice big display of what it's seeing. But there is a very large misconception out there that X-ray detects everything, but that's just simply not true. So dense contaminants, so you'll get dense metals, stainless steel, ferrous, most non-ferrous metals, but the light ones, magnesium, aluminum, anything that's quite low density metal is going to be very difficult to detect with an X-ray machine. You will get some rock glass detection at sort of larger pieces depending on the source of the glass and the source of the rock. Some rocks and glass are pretty low density, actually. So it really is a simple test, glass or water, and that'll pretty much give you the result that you can expect with the X-ray machine.
Really? So, okay, I guess what metal detectors, what can they not detect? I know it's metal, but are there limitations with the metal detector?
Yeah, there's always limitations. Of course, firstly, it's metal, and a lot of people even think a metal detector can detect glass and stone, but we do get those questions quite often. But it is really a metal detection system. Anything that's magnetic or conductive, as we said earlier. Now, there are limitations. Certain metals are harder to detect than others, so in most applications that would be non-magnetic stainless steel. It's a lousy conductor, it's not magnetic, so it's harder to detect than other metals. Ferrous is usually the easiest. And of course you've got products themselves that you're trying to inspect that may have one of those characteristics too. You have added iron, you have moisture and salt and acids in certain food products. They themselves create a large signal that tends to try to mask metal. Again, usually stainless gets hit the hardest, so there are limitations depending on the aperture size, product temperatures. Product effect will throw a sort of wrench into the system, so you will actually limit the performance of the detector. It's still going to detect metal, all metals. And research have shown that of all the metal, all the contaminants rather, any contaminant source that's detectable by any technology, metal is by far the most common. So anything that can be detected, metal is part of the process. It's part of the factory. It's part of coming off the farm. It's coming from the field. So bang for the buck, the metal detector is always job one. It will do an excellent job. It's a recognized technology. And in some applications, it will outperform an X-ray on any metal type. If metal is your target, it should be your number one target. In some applications, the X-ray will exceed the performance of the metal detector for dense metals, namely stainless steel.
Okay, so is a metal detector really best suited only for dry applications?
No, it works excellent on a lot of wet products, and the technology's moved so far in the past 10, 15 years that even conductive products today can be inspected, especially those that are smaller package or very consistently presented to the detector, etc. The performance on wet products today is pretty similar to what we did with dry products, 15 years ago. So it's still, when you look at the cost differential, a metal detector should always be choice number one. Then if you have other issues, you have other metals that you must detect, stainless steel down to a much lower level, or if you consider glass, bone, rock, a risk in your product, those could be well worth investing in an X-ray machine in addition to your metal detector. You never want to replace a metal detector with an X-ray machine. You will lose virtually all detection to very low density metals unless they're a very large chunk. And that's a classic example is, as I used before, the pop can. I use it because it's happened three or four times to people that have taken out metal detection, replaced it with what they thought was a better technology. It's certainly a more expensive technology. And then only to find that a half a pop can pass right through an X-ray machine and not be detected. It's a bit of a surprise. So if you're going to go down the X-ray route, it usually is you have a specific need, you have a product that's limiting metal detection, or you have contaminants that aren't metal. that are detectable in your product. And it has to be very dense contaminants. Then an X-ray machine starts to look attractive. It has some obvious benefits in technology and detectability that a metal detector doesn't have. But you really need to do your research, and should never take out the metal detector if you have one. They're complementary technologies. Ideally, you have both. It depends on the risk analysis that you must do with your product, but metal detector always, X-ray if you have specific needs and you have a budget to both live with it, buy it, and live with the machinery.
Okay, well, there's a lot that you said there, especially with the budget. Let's talk about the cost of ownership for a second. Metal detectors or X-ray machines tend to be about 5 to 10 times more the price of a metal detector. And the average life is about 2 years longer. Metal detectors are about 2 years longer, 2 to 5 years longer. Do you agree with that?
Well, it really will depend on a lot of factors, environmental especially, how much water, moisture. X-ray machines don't like water around the machine very much. Certainly, they can be built to withstand it. The dust, heat, cold temperatures, all of those things affect an X-ray machine, will shorten its lifespan, or certainly shorten some of the components' lifespans. So purchasing an X-ray machine, you're usually looking at a factor of 10 times the cost of the metal detector, 5 to 10 times, let's say, depending on the size of the application. Looking after the X-ray machine regular yearly, you'll need to budget considerably more than a metal detector, and it'll be 20 to 30 times the cost of regular yearly cost expenses. So it's not insignificant investment to go down the X-ray route, and that's why we certainly suggest you look at what your risks are and what the benefits it will bring, and don't replace the detector. Use it as a complementary technology.
So if it's complementary, where are we actually using a metal detector and X-ray on the production line? What is the optimal detection point for each?
Usually an X-ray machine is going to favor being end-of-line inspection. A metal detector is suited to go end-of-line, but also up in the process. So it's very handy to do gravity systems where products moving at very high speed that doesn't lend itself to X-ray. Speed limitation, etc. So mostly an X-ray machine would be end-of-line detection, and you would normally also have a metal detector there if your packaging allows it. And that's another excellent advantage of an X-ray machine, is if you have metal packaging, cans, aluminum foil, pie plates, that kind of thing, that will basically eliminate the detector's capability at that point. An X-ray can still be used to detect, again, most metals and dense contaminants.
Well, I mean, that seems like where the direction the industry is going with food preservation, marketing, metallized film, foil containers.
In some cases, yes, but people like to microwave things. So our market, especially in North America, is very microwave-oriented. So we do see a lot more foil packaging in Europe than we do in North America. But in North America, you see a trend away from that, both from a cost point of view and the old microwave that everybody wants to use.
All right, well, that makes sense. Now, you did mention something about gravity and speed. X-ray machines can't handle gravity systems?
Not that kind of speed. Usually, they're getting better. So an X-ray machine's typically probably limited to 200, 250 feet a minute, maybe something like that, 75 meters a minute. It will depend on a few factors. They are getting faster, there's no doubt about it. But a gravity application, you could see products passing through at 800, 1500 feet a minute. And at that point, the metal detector works great, and an X-ray machine is going to not be able to do much for you.
Okay, fair enough. With product optimizing your unit for your specific product. Metal detectors, you have to tune it. You have to adjust your settings to match that product specifically. X-rays, does it have that same issue?
They both have product limitations. So the metal detectors limited products that have added iron, which is magnetic, so cerial, etc. And you'd have to calibrate to that. And then you've got wet products, what we call wet products, where there's salt moisture present. And that's going to limit your performance, and you can basically also use the detector to learn that background signal. It'll still be a limiting factor, but to a large extent, you can ignore or at least tune out most of the product effect from that. A product effect from an X-ray point of view would be, because it's a density discriminator, if you have a product that has quite variable densities within the package. So the classic example is, you know, Raisin Bran cereal, where you get the box has some density, the bran has very low density, and you got speckles of raisins in there. They're actually quite dense. So you get this variable density. And if you put a contaminant in that box, you'll get different responses of detectability depending on whether it lands on a raisin or where it lands on a bran flakes, where there's very few flakes in the box. So it's the total density that you're actually looking at through that product. And then there will be areas in that product, in that box, in most applications where there's very low density. So even when you put a contaminant in there, it's the total density you're measuring. So if it happens to land in a place of low density product, you may or may not detect that same sample as you would if you put it where the density is higher.
Now, using that same Raisin Bran box example, what happens when you have recycled cardboard and there's metal in the cardboard?
Well, it will depend. Both case metal detector and X-ray won't like most recycled cardboard to some extent. Recycled board tends to be contaminated with both ferrous and non-ferrous contaminants. Aluminum foil is a big contaminant in recycled cardboard, and therefore the X-ray will not see that. It doesn't see aluminum foil very well, at all, in fact, at that level. So it has the advantage of being able to go through that, but you still get a lot of staples and chunks of ferrous metal that are in recycled boards. So in either case, you're going to have some potential issues with recycled packaging material.
Okay, let's focus on contaminants a bit. How does orientation of a contaminant affect a metal detector compared to an X-ray?
Yeah, if you take an odd-shaped piece of metal and pass it through in different directions, you're going to find a different response. And that's why we use spheres to actually test a metal detector, because it's the same, reflects the same amount of signal regardless of which direction it's pointing. It doesn't have direction. So if you flatten that out, or if you roll it into a needle shape or a wire shape, you're going to get a significant difference of signal depending on how it passes through the detector. That's just the physics of how it's breaking the lines in the field. So that is a concern. We're always aware of that. We try to promote the fact that the rule of thumb is if it's any one of its dimensions is less than the detectable sphere size of that metal type, then you may have difficulty detecting it. It actually might get bigger signal than the sphere, depending on how it passes through. But it's a bit of an odds game. X-ray, you have a similar thing. You have a light beam, if you can picture that. So you have this beam of light. You have detection system underneath that beam that's usually a series of diodes. It could be a camera system as well. But in either case, something that's very thin on edge will create very, it's actually, even though the density is quite high through its length or its edge dimension, it's so small in across the belt, if you like, that it may or may not be detected, even though it's a large piece of metal. And the same thing is if it's very, very thin and it will go through flat, the total density might be very, very little. So you can get blade shapes that will potentially be very difficult for an X-ray machine. That's even on a material like stainless steel or ferrous metals, where you get these flakes or blade shapes that will be extremely difficult to detect for an X-ray machine. And in fact, that's a case where the metal detector will seriously outperform it.
Speaking of detection, what can you detect? How low can you detect? And what are the factors for that detection? Like, how small can a metal detector detect, and how small can an X-ray detect?
In both cases, the prime factor will be how big is the product, how big is the aperture. On metal detectors, the field gets weaker as the aperture gets bigger, so in the center of the field, you'll have less potential for detecting contaminants. So a very small detector, no problem in a pharmaceutical size in 0.1 millimeter kind of suction range, right up to 2 or 3, 4 millimeters if it's a large bulk inspection application for a large aperture. Wouldn't be untypical. X-ray, same thing. A smaller machine or a smaller distance between the X-ray beam and the detection point, you'll have a denser field. You'll get lower. You'll get be detecting smaller contaminants. But it tends to be limited also by the detection technology that you're using at the on the detection side. So if it's a diode array, if you have 0.8 or 0.4 millimeter diodes, that's pretty much your detection limit. Some camera systems will be a little bit better than that, but tends to be the product will limit it anyway. So at the very low end, metal detector will outperform an X-ray machine on metal contaminants of all types. But as the aperture size gets bigger, the difference becomes more noticeable, where the X-ray will usually outperform metal detector on dense metals like stainless, and the metal detector will outperform the X-ray machine on low density metals like aluminum.
So with an X-ray machine, if it's a larger product, larger aperture, does that mean you need like a more powerful camera, more powerful equipment to detect?
You will most likely need more powerful X-ray generation in order to pass through a bigger product, especially if it's a dense product. So if you took a 50-pound bag of flour, 6 to 8 inches of reasonably dense material, could be even worse if it was, say, sugar, very high density, you're going to need a lot of power to get through that. On the plus side, it tends to be a homogeneous product with very low density variation, so it's a relatively easy product from that point of view.
And with metal detectors, the larger the aperture, large product, is there more power required with that?
Yeah, there is. It takes a little bit more power, but you're talking about a few volts rather than kilovolts on the X-ray machine, where you get thousands of volts of energy that you're creating. And you maybe need to go from a 60 kV generator to 120 or 150 kV generator. That's kilovolts. That's a lot of power you're going to need.
Okay, so I'm assuming with this increased power, there's more concern of operator safety, operator usage of the machine.
New subject in terms of safety relationship, where the metal detectors recognized as not being a safety risk factor to anybody. And in fact, your computer display generates more RF than the metal detector in most cases. The X-ray machine, you have obviously a much greater safety risk, so you don't want to expose operators, etc. And there are safety rules in place that limit how much leakage a machine is allowed to have. So as you up the power, you'll also have to usually up the cabinet size and length to be able to absorb X-ray, so that at the exits, especially exit and entry, you're going to still be within the prescribed limit.
Okay, so Steve, so with detection points with the line, we just addressed that. But critical control points, we have the HACCP, we have intense HACCP planning, external auditors coming in. Which unit should we be using for CCP?
In theory, you can use either technology. Our recommendation and logic would say use the metal detector as the CCP. It will meet the requirement. It's more testable, it's more understandable, and it's by far more reliable. So a metal detector has a whole lot less in it to go wrong. It's bulletproof reliability. There's no heat sources. And you can actually repair it with your own maintenance crew usually in literally minutes. So if you need to shut the line down because the CCP point has failed, then your metal detector is 10 to 1, 20 to 1 better option to go with. An x-ray machine, reliability is always going to be an issue. There's a lot more going on in the machine. There's a lot of heat. There's a lot of susceptibility to the environment. And it is not a machine that lends itself to home mechanics or home repairs or in-house repairs, if you like. It's because of the safety issues of both the radiation factor, and you're dealing potentially with some very, very high voltage components. So if it breaks down, you're bringing somebody from the outside. They may have to fly parts in. So you're looking at potentially downtime of a long time. So recommendation, keep the metal detector as your CCP, put them both in series, and the x-ray is a bonus. And they cover each other, they complement each other, both machines in line work well together.
So with metal detectors, are operators or maintenance teams allowed to change parts in a metal detector?
Yeah, operators no, but I would say most maintenance departments and most food plants can easily get a metal detector up and running these days with some spare parts or just settings. And the fact that it's so much more reliable to begin with because there's just a lot less in the machine, the risk of failure is very, very low.
Interesting. Okay, so we looked at all the contaminants and what the head-to-head the differences between an x-ray and a metal detector, but is there anything more outside of detecting contaminants that these units can do?
Yeah, both of them have potential bonus application. Metal detector, the most common is what we call reverse detection, where we're actually looking, let's say, in a cereal box where there's a toy. Quite often they put a metallized film strip on that toy to identify it, and we can make sure the toy's there and still inspect for metal. Similarly, you can look for the inclusion quite often of oxygen absorber packs in a lot of meat products. We can ensure that the absorber is in the pack and at the same time with the same detector detect contaminants, metal contaminants in there as well. An x-ray machine probably has even more potential for that, where you can look for missing components on sort of ready meals. Broken, mispackaged product can be identified. So there definitely are some bonus features from both technologies that can be used and should be looked at if your product actually is one of those that qualifies that could use some of those features.
All right, well, that's interesting, Steve. You gave me a lot to unpackage in terms of examining x-rays and metal detectors head-to-head. I'm a customer. I'm coming to you now saying, hey, here's my blank check. I'm on board. I want to support the prevention. What do I buy? What do I need to do?
Yeah, it's we do have to talk people down, especially on x-ray. People come in from metal detection point of view, and you almost have to convince them they need it. From an x-ray point of view, if they're looking at that, we have to convince them that maybe they don't need it. Or that their expectations are just beyond what the machine can do. Because everybody has this common conception that x-ray sees everything. Wood, like I said before, feathers and things like that, insects, probably the most common contaminant in the food industry. You can't detect any of that with any technology. So it is a difficult one. We'd certainly like to take the big check on the x-ray machine, but I would say in most applications, you must have the metal detector first. The x-ray should be a complementary and secondary technology if you have a need. If you have contaminants that aren't detectable well with the metal detector and they're common in your type of product, then an x-ray machine should definitely be something you need to look at.
All right. Well, I really appreciate this, Steve. I really appreciate the insight and your time for coming in. Hopefully you'll join us again on future shows to help spread your knowledge.
Thank you.
So again, this is Food Safety First. If you have any questions, comments, concerns, feedback, please email us at foodsafetyfirst@fortresstechnology.com. Thank you.